Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Agents of Darkness by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Devon Sorvari. Chapter 36.
Hands up, asshole!
A burst of green light hurtled toward the Fro agent standing just inside the doorway. Whoever it was fired fell darts, then Cheyenne Summerlin burst through the door into the chaos of another Fro raid, this time on purpose. A column of violet fire streaked toward her head, and the drow halfling ducked before sending a missile of crackling black energy toward the sneering goblin who'd attacked her. His blue-green grin disappeared when her spell hit him in the face a second before the fire crashed into the wall behind her. Something heavy and metal toppled to the ground with a clang. Cheyenne spun around to see the helmet rolling away from the rest of a fallen suit of armor before she returned to the fight.
Jesus, what a place, huh?
Beside her, Yurik fired his fell pistol. The skaxen he'd aimed at dodged the first and caught the rest of the weapon's fire in the gut, screaming as he hit the floor.
Shitbags in a mansion are still shitbags, Bondi said, ducking a flashing attack of red magic spinning toward her like a throwing star.
Her fell pistol caught the attacking troll in the hip, and then the knee, and she growled when he went down. The Fro spread out across the huge foyer and into the multiple rooms on the first floor, magic and fell darts flying everywhere and obliterating the expensive decor. Cheyenne's lashing black tendrils shot from her hands and wrapped around an orc with his meaty fist clamped down around an agent's arm. The tendrils whipped around the orc's wrist and jerked his arm back. The Fro agent was tossed aside. But the orc was a lot more focused now on the thick coils of drow magic crushing his windpipe. The halfling let the orc drop and raised a black, shimmering shield of magic between Yurik and the bullet some asshole had tried to put in his helmet. The bullet pinged off Cheyenne's shield, and the huge, muscular goblin turned toward her, his grin barely visible through the mask of his helmet.
Yeah, I'm sticking with you. I don't care what you do as long as we find those kids, Cheyenne snarled.
She let off one crackling burst of black energy after another at the screaming, sneering magicals poorly defending their new hiding place.
That's why we're here.
She moved through the chaos and the multicolored spells crossing the foyer against fell darts and larger fell explosives. Glass shattered somewhere behind her, and Bondi nudged Cheyenne forward from behind just before a massive pane of stained glass crashed to the floor where the halfling had stood.
We got your back, drow.
The troll woman nodded toward the rest of the battle and the agents destroying the well-kept mansion.
Let's go.
Cheyenne flung attacking magicals aside with her lashing tendrils, ducking under flying spells and weaving around the black magic targets and Fro agents alike. Bondi and Yurik flanked her without a word, picking off their own targets as they moved through the house. On the other side of the foyer, a huge winding staircase led up to a second floor. Five Fro agents were spread out along the first few steps, exchanging fire with a giant ogre crashing down the staircase toward them. Cheyenne glanced up at the second floor landing and the balcony overlooking the fight below. Off the top of the stairs was a set of double doors guarded by another ogre and a scrawny orange skaxen. Both of them hurled attack spells into the fray, but they didn't move from their post beside the door.
There! Second floor! Cheyenne shouted.
Bondi and Yurik glanced up at the balcony and nodded. The ogre on the staircase let out a mighty bellow and swung a huge fist at the agents in front of him. Most of them leaped aside, firing before one poor bastard took an ogre fist to the side of the helmet. The agent staggered sideways into the staircase banister, and the ogre lifted his fist to bring it down on the stunned operative's head. Cheyenne threw a shield up over the agent's helmet. The ogre's fist struck it like a giant gong, and he reeled backward, roaring.
Let's go! She led her new fro friends past all the fighting, dodging flying spells and throwing up shields to keep whatever agents she could from getting a face or a belly or a back full of criminal magic. Yeah, I think I'm getting the hang of this. They reached the bottom of the staircase as the stunned agent against the banister gained his footing. The other four trained their fell weapons on the bellowing ogre. Yurik detached one of the round black grenades from his belt and shouted, "Fell fire in the hole!" The agents nearly skidded down the last few steps before the muscular goblin launched the fell grenade. It struck the ogre in the chest and stuck there, flashing green light before it erupted. The mansion trembled, and dust and bits of chipped plaster rained down on everyone. The ogre bellowed and crashed against the wall following the staircase.
"Damn it," Yurik spat. "They just don't go down."
The ogre pushed himself back up to his feet, shaking his head. Plaster and drywall spilled off his hulking shoulders. A magical screamed in the foyer before something else exploded, and Cheyenne headed up the stairs. "He will." The agents flanked her as she made her way toward the ogre, who glared at her with heavily lidded eyes. She threw crackling black energy balls and struck the asshole in the hip, belly, and chest. One huge foot crashed down another step toward her, and a dagger of orange magic materialized in his scarred gray palm. The halfling sighed. "Ogres and magical weapons, huh? Looks like it." Bondi trained her pistol on the ogre's hand and fired. The fell shots glanced off the ogre's wrist before he threw the orange dagger toward the troll woman. Cheyenne raised another shield, deflecting the tossed weapon spell, and advanced up the stairs again. High-pitched laughter came from more than one magical behind her on the first floor, but she ignored it. "I've got backup. I better." The ogre moved faster than she expected, flinging orange daggers left and right with both hands. The halfling managed to raise a shield in front of each intended target, mostly herself, but couldn't get enough downtime to attack. Then the skaxen and the other ogre guarding the door upstairs started flinging spells at the fro agents and the drow halfling. A shrill, maddened cackle escaped the skaxen's gaping orange mouth. Bondi aimed her weapon at the balcony and squeezed off a quick round. The banister exploded in shards of green light and wood. Then the magicals upstairs were fully engaged, too.
"We'll keep 'em busy," another agent shouted.
Cheyenne dodged another orange dagger from the ogre's huge fist and used that moment to lash out with her black tendrils. They curled around the hulking gray magical's wrists, tightening instantly. For a moment, the half-drow and the ogre struggled against each other, their strength nearly matched. Then the ogre quit trying to spread his arms and jerked them up instead. That yanked Cheyenne up the stairs. Grunting, she caught herself on the next step just before the ogre reared sideways and threw his wrists in a sweeping arc over his head and up the stairs toward the second floor. The halfling flew, too, barely avoiding the bursts of purple and red magic shooting through the mansion. She crashed against the wall at the top of the stairs, grimacing while the ogre chuckled and headed toward her. Her black tendrils drew back, and she kicked herself off against the wall to enter drow speed. With a crack, time in the entire mansion slowed, and Cheyenne darted down the stairs again. The ogre's foot was lifted halfway in his attempt to climb the stairs. She let off half a dozen black spheres, peppering his body from knee to head, then sent black tendrils to coil around his standing leg. When she jerked sideways, the ogre's foot barely moved, so she slipped behind him on the stairs and clamped both hands down around the backs of his knees. "More than one way to take you down, asshole." Her black energy spheres crackled in her hands, their light bursting around the ogre's legs before something splintered beneath her fingers. Then she shoved with all her strength and sent the huge magical crashing toward the railing. A wave of
dizziness passed through her, and time sped up again. The mansion erupted with shouts and growls and hissing magic crashing into bodies and walls. The ogre added his bellowing scream to the din as he crashed through the balcony and dropped like a boulder on the unsuspecting goblins below. Blinking off the dizziness, Cheyenne pushed off the wall and started climbing the steps. "Oh, shit!" Bondi peered through the splintered banister. "Did you just blast off his legs?" A spiraling yellow bolt cracked against the next shield the half-drow lifted in front of the troll agent, and Cheyenne turned her attention to the second ogre and the skaxen trying to defend that door. The other agents rushed up the stairs, firing fell rounds at the magicals. The halfling had to steady herself with a hand against the wall again, and Yurik stopped beside her with his weapon raised.
"You okay?"
"Yeah, just get them away from the door, huh? I think the kids are in there, but I gotta check first, and I need a moment to do that."
"No repeat of that bomb in a crate."
Yurik nodded.
"We'll cover you."
Then he darted off down the second floor hallway toward the ogre and the skaxen, added his own fell shots to the melee. Cheyenne shook out her hands and headed after him toward the door. The second ogre didn't go down beneath the fell fire either. Roaring, he swept his huge arms left and right, fending off the agents who didn't have enough firepower to do much more than distract him. The skaxen leaped onto the balcony and ran across it on all fours like a giant orange rat. Someone shot at him as he scrambled forward, but the fell darts went wild. Then the skaxen leaped toward Cheyenne. She unleashed another crackling black sphere and hit the snarling orange magical in the thigh before he crashed into her and knocked them both against the wall, then fell to the floor in a heap. Snarling, the halfling batted the skaxen's sharp claws away from her face as he scrambled to get a good hold on her. He somehow managed to get a grip on the collar of her jacket and lifted her off the ground before slamming her head back down.
"All you have to do is swear fealty, Morukare," the orange guy hissed, spit flying from between his razor-sharp teeth. "That's all she wants. This'll all be over if you just give yourself to the crown and let her handle the rest."
"No fucking way." Cheyenne brought her elbow down on the side of the skaxen's head. It knocked him off her just enough for her to roll out from under him. His claws raked through her jacket and into the flesh beneath as she grabbed him by his thin black shirt and threw him off her. The rat-like magical screamed as he soared over the balcony. Leaping to her feet, the halfling launched two more crackling black orbs at his chest, both of which hit him before he slammed into the floor beside the bloody stumps of the fallen ogre's legs.
"I don't know who these assholes think I am, but I'm not swearing shit to anyone."
With a deep breath, she turned back toward the seven fro agents trying to bring down a snarling, raving ogre on their own. Chapter 37. Cheyenne darted around the agents, who were firing round after round of fell shots into the ogre's gray flesh. It was enough of a distraction for the halfling to get to those guarded double doors unseen. Just a few seconds to make sure. She pressed her palm against the door and closed her eyes, bringing up her drow sight. A hot blast of green fire erupted by her hand, and she leaped aside before glancing over the balcony. Two orcs pulled up more fire to launch at her, and she scattered them with handfuls of hissing black energy.
"I need cover!"
Yurik ducked under the ogre's sweeping arm and turned on one knee to level his pistol at the orcs. They dodged his first few shots, and Cheyenne turned back to the door.
"Make it quick."
She closed her eyes and pulled up her drow sight again, pouring all her focus into that one ability because that was the only way. Another crackling dart of magic whizzed past her head, and she hissed out a frustrated breath.
"Come on."
A faint blue outline appeared in her mind's eye, huddled on the ground just beyond the door. Then another blast of magic struck the wooden floor beside her feet, and the halfling jerked back. "That's good enough for me." "They're in here," she shouted, and reached for the door handle. But there wasn't one. Of course not. Cheyenne stepped back and blasted the door with a black sphere. An orange and red light flared around the door, and that was it. Shit, wards too? The Frow agents repeated the shout of getting upstairards to break down those doors. The operatives fighting the ogre were busy enough as it was, and the others downstairs were sweeping through the mansion, trying to gather at the stairs and getting cut off by the kidnappers. Bondi let out a battle cry and tossed two fell grenades at the ogre. The other agents hit the deck before the black discs detonated. The blast sent Cheyenne reeling away from the door as more spells flew up from the foyer and hit the wall beside her head. The ogre roared and slapped a meaty gray hand to his eye, blood spewing everywhere. Then Yorick was at Cheyenne's side, studying the double doors from top to bottom.
"Didn't think a drow needed to use doorknobs."
"Wards." She pointed at the door and threw up a shield in front of three more agents running up the stairs. The purple shards of some goblin's attack ricocheted off the black light of the shield, and the agents kept running. They skirted past the ogre, who still roared and stumbled around, blinded by shrapnel.
"You know anything about wards?"
Yorick asked. "That door would be open if I did."
"Right."
He stepped back and fired fell shots into the door, which only brought up the orange and red glow of protective wards without doing any damage. Turning back toward the fighting, the goblin roared,
"Anyone got a blaster?"
A massive explosion made the floor tremble beneath their feet. Cheyenne staggered as a blast of smoke and debris hurtled into the foyer from another room downstairs. Frow agents ran away from the blast, ducking debris and throwing spells and firing their fell rifles where they could. A raging scream below made Cheyenne peer over the balcony. Three Skaxen stood in a half circle, their arms outstretched in front of a black circle opening in midair.
"What the hell is that?"
Yorick shouted.
"A portal,"
the halfling snarled and stormed toward the balcony.
"Get that door open,
or we're screwed." She launched black energy spheres over the balcony, hitting two of the Skaxen's legs. They screamed and jumped around. The growing portal downstairs shivered, but held steady. Cheyenne reached out with her flailing black tendrils, but she was too far away. The drow whips smacked one Skaxen's sweaty orange face, but that was it. Then a troll spewed a column of dripping blue magic up at her. The halfling retracted her tendrils to throw up a shield around herself, the blue spell splashing against it like thick magical mud. Someone fired more shots at the doors behind her, and the orange and red wards flashed even brighter. Cheyenne glanced quickly from the Skaxen's growing portal to the agents locked in battle at the foot of the stairs. More of them climbed the stairs, occasionally turning back to fire their weapons and keep the pursuing magicals at bay. The ogre kept fighting, swinging blindly, but still not going down. "We bit off more than we could chew this time." A bright flash of silver light burst through the open door downstairs, and the entire fight changed. The three Skaxens summoning a portal were first. Two of them clutched their necks, blood spraying all over the third before he screamed and crashed into the wall. The portal fizzled out with a pop. The silver streak blurred across the foyer again. Fights between Frow agents and magicals were broken up in an instant, the silver bursts of light striking the black magic enemies. Some went flying through the air, while agents staggered back in surprise. Some magicals lost limbs or dropped where they stood, choking and gasping before falling over. The silver lightning darted back and forth across the foyer, leaving the agents untouched and everything else destroyed in its wake. In a flash, it raced past the agents being pushed down the stairs again by the enraged and blinded ogre. Blinding silver light ripped his gray flesh from navel to chin, and the ogre dropped.
What the hell? Who's doing that? Just gutted the bastard like a fish.
The silver streak moved in a blur that was impossible to see, heading for Cheyenne and Yurik beside the double doors. The orange and red wards erupted in a flash of light. The doors burst open, and then the silver flash darted away. Cheyenne changed into drow speed, surrounded by Fro operatives, frozen in shock and bewilderment. She ran down the hall toward the staircase and leaped down two at a time.
Corian!
The Night Stalker moved quickly down the stairs, but didn't bother to look at her.
Hey, I know you hear me!
When she'd made it halfway down the stairs, he whirled to face her and hissed, his silver eyes flashing in the super-speed stasis around them.
I didn't give you that pendant so you could take it off to play drow superhero, kid.
What? The halfling moved the rest of the way down the staircase toward him.
You know what? You're the one who didn't tell me what it does. And I asked. Me telling you to do something should be enough. I'm not risking my neck to help you if you keep insisting on being a moron.
Look, asshole, it's a good thing I figured out what the pendant does, or I would have walked in here without magic. Cheyenne glanced at the carnage in the foyer and pointed to the ogre with his legs blown off.
And I'd end up like one of those guys. I came here to find those kids, and I'm not about to turn my magic off just to make you feel safer. I am safe, Cheyenne.
Baring his teeth, Corian stormed toward her, his fists clenched at his sides.
I've been safe for hundreds of years on this side, and the only thing that's coming even remotely close to blowing my cover and bringing it all crashing down around me is you. I have my orders, and I'm following them. Suck it the hell up and do the same.
I don't take orders, Night Stalker. That's not what this is about.
Everyone in this house knew you were here. Who do you think that Skaxon portal was for, huh? You charged in here like an idiot without any protection, and you need to get it through your thick drow head that the game has changed.
Cheyenne shook her head.
What are you talking about?
The Night Stalker's silver eyes darted around the destroyed foyer, littered with criminal bodies.
This is the last time I pull your head out of your ass for you. Got it? Put the fucking pendant back on.
He turned without another word and stalked back out of the house. As he stepped through the doorway, Cheyenne's enhanced speed fell away.
Holy shit. Yurik muttered, staring through the open double doors on the second floor,
before reaching out to nudge the halfling he still thought stood beside him.
You were right about... What?
He turned quickly and found her standing at the bottom of the stairs.
What the hell are you doing down there? We got the kids. Hey!
The goblin agent waved for the rest of the team to join him in front of the double doors. Beside the debris spilling out of the room next to the foyer, Reinhardt ripped off his helmet and stared at the halfling.
What the hell was that?
Cheyenne turned toward him and grimaced. Those kids are a lot more important right now, don't you think? She ignored his irritated mumbling as she stalked back up the stairs with the other Fro agents to join Yurik by the door. Some still gazed around in amazement, taking their helmets off to get a better view of the destruction.
Hey, kids, one of the agents said gently from just outside the door.
He set his helmet on the floor, holstered his weapon, and waved for the terrified kidnapping victims to come out of the warded dungeon they'd been crammed into for at least a day.
Everything's okay. We're gonna get you all out of here and take you home.
Cheyenne's enhanced hearing picked up heavy, frightened breathing from the beings inside that room. Some of the magical kids started crying. A goblin boy, about 12 or 13, was the first to step through the door. He gazed around the mansion with wide eyes, taking in the dead bodies, the blood-stained floors, and the walls riddled with charred holes and cracks and missing huge chunks. Then he turned toward the agent who'd spoken to the kids and stuck out his hand.
Thank you.
The agent looked startled. Then he gripped the goblin boy's hand and gave it a firm shake.
Doing our job, kid. If you want to thank somebody, go shake the drow's hand.
The kid's eyes grew wide when he saw Cheyenne standing at the top of the stairs. The image of the goblin boy dressed up in robes and lying dead in that church came uninvited to Cheyenne's mind. She blinked at him, swallowed, and muttered, "Just help everyone else get out of there. You guys will be fine." Then the drow halfling brushed past the other Fro agents. Reinhardt stared at her as she stormed through the foyer. She had to swerve to avoid the bodies scattered all over the place, and she felt his gaze on her even when she stepped outside into the early evening. We only made it out of this because of Corian. Maybe he was right. Cheyenne jammed her hand into the outside pocket of her jacket and took out the Heart of Midnight pendant. The gem glittered at her in the orange and pink light of sunset, and she begrudgingly put it back on, tying a little knot in the thing's silver chain because she'd broken the clasp. Her drow magic and the heat of her rage disappeared, squashed back down inside her by the protective spell of Corian's stupid necklace. Her bone-white hair darkened into her regular, high-voltage raven black, the purple-gray of her drow skin lightening to her human paleness. The pointed tips of her ears disappeared beneath her hair again. Clenching her fists, she took off toward the line of Fro vehicles parked at the curb just beyond the mansion. I just need a minute to cool off. Then I'll come back to help those kids get to their parents. Chapter 38. When the last wide-eyed and shell-shocked magical kid was loaded into the last black Fro van called in for transport, Cheyenne nodded at the agent who shut the door. That agent got behind the wheel, her partner in the passenger seat beside her, and the van took off after all the other vehicles. Reinhardt tossed his helmet, vest, and dampening gloves into the back of his Jeep and whistled, "Let's go." It took a lot of willpower to pull her gaze away from that last retreating van, but she finally managed it and turned to head for the passenger side door of the Jeep. Once she closed the door behind her, Reinhardt started the engine with a jerking twist and slowly left the neighborhood. "Let me guess," Cheyenne muttered. "The cleaning crew comes later." "Different department." His hands tightened on the steering wheel. "Let's focus on ours, huh? Now that the most important job's out of the way and the kids are heading back to base, this is the part where you tell me who the hell our lightning bolt hero was." The halfling turned to frown at the agent, who was so focused on playing hardball with her that he squinted against the sunset, his sunglasses forgotten. "I can't tell you anything about that, Reinhardt. Not if he doesn't already know we had our asses saved by a night stalker, especially Corian." "You're getting really good at mimicry, you know that?" Reinhardt shot her a quick glance, blinked furiously against the sun, and jerked down the visor. It didn't do anything to block the glare. When he grunted in irritation, Cheyenne leaned forward and grabbed his sunglasses from the cubby beneath the dashboard. "Here."
"Yeah."
He snatched them from her, put them on with one hand, and shook his head.
"Don't expect me to believe for 1 second that you don't know shit about what happened in there. 1 minute, you're up there trying to knock down that door. The next minute, there's a goddamn silver tornado taking down every single one of our targets. And who's suddenly standing right there in front of me at the bottom of the stairs again?"
The halfling stared out the windshield, pressing her lips together.
"Not a rhetorical question, Cheyenne. I'm talking about you and the look on your face when our anonymous friend booked it back out that door. If you don't know who it was, you know something.
Spill it.
There's nothing to spill, man. Sorry. She couldn't look at him. I can't trust him either, and I'm not about to throw Corian under the bus, even if he called me a moron.
You're not sorry at all.
Reinhardt cleared his throat and turned onto the freeway to head toward Richmond. Half an hour later, they pulled up in front of the Red Diner where Cheyenne had negotiated herself into another meeting with Lazar just hours ago. Cheyenne glanced around the mostly empty parking lot and licked her lips in frustration.
I'm still not hungry. Just take me back to the compound with you so we can finish this thing with those kids.
Nice try, halfling. Reinhardt shifted into park and whipped his sunglasses off before fixing her with an angry scowl.
Wherever you're going tonight, it's not back to base. You have priorities to work out.
Thanks for the pep talk, she snorted. Right now, my top priority is helping those kids get back to their families.
Cross it off the list. And don't even try to sneak back to the compound after you get out of my car.
Yeah, I heard all about your fun little night out with my agents last night. There's no point in blindfolding you anymore on the drive over, but if I have to, I'll put out an order to keep you off the base for as long as it takes.
Cheyenne blinked furiously. You can't just tell me to screw off.
That's exactly what I'm doing, kid. Get out.
Hey, I'm the one who found those kids in the first place, asshole.
It threw her off more than she'd expected when the usual heat of her drow magic didn't show up at all with her anger.
They'd still be locked up in that psychotic ritual den if I hadn't found the connection to Ranzig Cadmar.
Yeah, you get full credit for that one. Go get yourself a cookie.
Reinhardt nodded toward the driver's side door, his eyes narrowing.
My guys are the ones who get to deal with those kids now. You're off the hook, unless you want to spill this second what you're trying not to tell me.
I can't believe this.
There's nothing to tell.
Then get the hell out of my Jeep and call me when you're ready to talk about what happened back there. We're done.
Biting down hard on her lower lip, Cheyenne let out a little growl and jerked open the passenger side door. Reinhardt took off in the Jeep the same second she slammed the door shut behind her. She was left standing in front of her scuffed, chipped, matte gray Ford Focus in the diner's parking lot. When she jammed her hand back into the pocket of her jacket to grab her keys, she hissed and glanced down at her forearm. The jacket sleeves had been ripped almost to shreds by that crazed Skaxon, spouting crazier demands about swearing fealty, and her forearms burned now. She unlocked her car, opened the door, and gingerly shrugged out of the jacket. It thumped onto the passenger seat. Then the halfling studied the long red gouges in her skin, some of them a quarter of an inch deep.
Skaxon asshole. Should have stocked up on healing ingredients at Paradosh last night.
Cheyenne bent and dropped into the driver's seat, slammed the door shut behind her, and started the engine. For a few minutes, she just sat there, debating whether Reinhardt's warning was worth listening to tonight. Then she shook her head and buckled up. I already played my leverage card to get into Chateau Drawl. Nobody likes a drow showing up uninvited and making more demands. The gray Ford Focus pulled out of the parking lot, and the halfling headed onto the highway toward downtown Richmond. With bags of takeout swinging from her hands, Cheyenne stalked down the corridor of the inpatient recovery ward of the VCU Medical Center. She didn't look up from the linoleum floor in front of her, even when she felt the nurses and care staff staring at the goth chick.
This stupid necklace might block off my magic, but I'm still pissed enough to be one scary human.
When she reached room 317, she did a little shuffle with the takeout bags before knocking quickly on the door.
Come in!
Ember sounded cheery enough, and she looked happy to see Cheyenne when the halfling pushed open the door. Then her smile faded.
What happened to you?
Weird day. Cheyenne shut the door behind her and headed across the hospital room toward her friend's bed. That's an understatement. You look like shit. The halfling stopped halfway across the room and looked at Ember in surprise. The magicless fae in the hospital bed smirked, and Cheyenne laughed. Okay, fine. Weird and seriously messed up day with a side order of what the fuck. Ember laughed. That's more like it. When she reached the other side of the bed, Cheyenne dropped the takeout bags on the rolling table, then turned to pull the ridiculously uncomfortable armchair as close as she could to her friend. Hope you're in the mood for burgers. Come on, Cheyenne. I'm always in the mood for burgers. Ember started unpacking the food, slowing a little when she noticed the nasty gouges in the half-drow's forearms. I'm also in the mood for hearing the wild story of how your arms met Freddy Krueger and why you have chunks of wall in your hair. That is just wall, right? What? The halfling leaned over the side of the armchair and ruffled her hair. The chains around her wrists clinked as drywall and plaster chunks dropped onto the floor. Oh, yeah. That. Just another day in halfling paradise, right? Uh-huh. Ember pulled one of the burgers into her lap and slowly unwrapped it. I'm listening. With a sigh, Cheyenne ran her hand through her hair again and looked at the ceiling for a good neck stretch. We found those kids. The kids? Eyes trained on the halfling, Ember took a huge bite of her burger. Barbecue sauce and a piece of onion ring landed on the paper wrapper with a splat. I didn't tell you about that? Cheyenne shrugged. Damn, I guess it's only been 2 days. Feels like 2 weeks. When she looked at Ember, the fae girl just stared at her and shoved more burger into her mouth, silently waiting for the halfling to keep going. Okay, this is gonna sound nuts. Ember laughed and managed not to spray her mouthful of greasy dinner all over her lap and the hospital blankets. Compared to what? All your stories are crazy, Cheyenne. It's the best part of my day when I get to hear them. You're just itching for your next fix of halfling drama, huh? Believe it or not, the entertainment's pretty lacking around here. Ember leaned toward her friend and whispered, I think the nurses are going out of their way to make sure I'm as bored as possible. Good thing we're friends. For the first time since finding out those magical kids had been kidnapped yesterday morning, Cheyenne Summerlin had a reason to smile. Okay, you eat, and I'll talk. Ember took another huge bite and wiggled her eyebrows. Chapter 39. Ember finished her burger and the side of sweet potato fries halfway through Cheyenne's story. The bomb at the construction site, all the kids' clothes in a pile, the halfling's second stay in the Froze medical wing. The fae sucked down the raspberry iced tea like she hadn't had anything to drink in days when Cheyenne got to the part about visiting Lazar a second time at Chateau Drawl. Sounds like he lost his mind in that place. The halfling shook her head. I'm pretty sure he was like that before they locked him up. Still not convinced he's sane. But he knew about that goblin pretending to be a Fro agent, right? Ember wiped her hands on a napkin and tossed it into the plastic takeout bag, shaking her head. I can't believe that sentence just came out of my mouth. Cheyenne chuckled and shrugged. Pretty weird to hear anything about all this insider Fro crap when you've been trying to stay away from them your whole life, huh? Maybe that's how I got into this mess. I had no idea who they were. Maybe. Or you're just a badass who can handle anybody. Yeah, right. Rolling her eyes, the halfling finished off the last of her burger and turned to her side of fries. And Lazar didn't know who the traitor was. Really? How do you figure that? How would he know? He's been locked up in there for decades. Okay, minus the 3-day vacation when he met my mom. Ember snorted.
I think it's more like Lazar knew that I knew, and he was just trying to dig up the pieces so I could see it all clearly and ignore everything else. Which is totally weird when I think about it like that. No kidding. Estranged prisoner dad knowing your head better than you do? Yeah, Cheyenne. I bet that's pretty creepy. The halfling munched on more fries. But it worked. And we found the assholes who took those kids. Got them all out of there safely, and they'll be back home by the end of the night. They better be. There's one thing I don't get, though, Ember said, then drained the last of her tea. What, I didn't give you enough of a detailed play-by-play? Cheyenne smirked. No, that part was great. Super efficient. But the half-drow I know wouldn't walk away from a bunch of terrified kids freshly pulled out of a kidnapper mansion. The Fae frowned with a small, confused smile. Why the hell did you come to see me instead of going with those kids? With a groan, Cheyenne slumped against the back of the armchair, grimacing at the dull ache in her forearms. We had a little help in that house, from a night stalker friend. For real? Who's apparently really pissed that I took off this stupid necklace to save all those kids, and nobody knows about him. Huh. Yeah. So my options were to give up the one person I know who knows Lazar Verdis, or be on my merry way. I've been kicked out of the Fro compound for now. Ember snorted. Their loss? Yeah. And Corian's pissed at me. I'm not going over to his place tonight after his little lecture on not being a halfling idiot. I thought about checking out the Borderland forums and at least letting the families know their kids are safe, but the guy's one of the admins on there, too. Guess I'm just not feeling the whole, let's pretend he didn't call me an idiot so we can act like nothing happened part. He'll cool off. Ember ran a hand through her hair and shrugged. You need him. He knows it. And it sounds like he's got a lot invested in your drow trials or whatever. Don't remind me. Cheyenne laughed. It's still weird. I have a night stalker professor showing me the ropes of not going apeshit whenever I'm pissed, and now I have a night stalker mentor who knows more about these stupid trials than I do, because he knows Lazar. And he found you at that mansion. Ember wrinkled her nose. That's creepy. Really puts the stalker in night stalker. I'm pretty sure he's been watching me for a long time, waiting for me to be ready. Jesus, I'm so tired of people telling me I have to wait till I'm ready. With a small laugh, Ember sat back against the elevated hospital bed and fluffed the limp pillow behind her back. You're the only person who gets to decide when you're ready, Cheyenne, and everybody knows it. The halfling studied the long gashes in her arms and let out another heavy sigh. And yet, everybody's trying to hold the halfling back. Trying and failing. They'll get it through their thick heads eventually. The Fae's grin was infectious, and Cheyenne found herself laughing with her friend. Thanks, Em. I'm glad I'm not the only person who gets it. That's what I'm here for, right? Your sidekick holed up in a knock. Came at the door, and without waiting for a reply, Dr. Andrews stepped into the room with a stack of papers in his hand. He paused when he caught sight of the goth chick looking like she'd just been dragged through a demolition site, then closed the door behind him. I see your mysterious friends come back for another visit. Hey, Doc. Cheyenne gave him a tight smile. How's it going? Well, I can say with complete confidence that my night's been a lot less exciting than yours. The halfling shrugged and shared a knowing glance with her friend. If you say so. But I do have some exciting news for you, Ms. Gaydrow. Should I assume you'd like your friend here with you to hear it? That's a pretty safe assumption, yeah. Ember grinned as Dr. Andrews approached the foot of her hospital bed. Her eyes trained on the paperwork in his hands. Okay, then. We've got everything set up to get you discharged and out of here tomorrow, Ember. At this point, there's not much more we can do for you here at the hospital, so you get to go home.
If you're ready for it, I've got a referral to get you started with physical therapy on Monday.
Seriously? Ember's face lit up, and she turned toward Cheyenne to flash her friend a goofy, open-mouthed expression of surprise. I'm getting out!
Tomorrow, yes.
Dr. Andrews glanced at the friends and readjusted his glasses.
You'll need someone to help you get home and settled into a slightly different routine.
Cheyenne snorted. I've met doctors with zero bedside manner. You're not one of them.
If that's a compliment, thank you.
You're welcome.
These are your discharge instructions.
Dr. Andrews stepped around the other side of the bed to hand the papers to Ember.
You'll sign everything else tomorrow, and then you're on to the next step.
Awesome. Ember scanned the papers, flipping through them quickly and shaking her head in disbelief.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.